And now it's my pleasure to introduce tonight's speaker, Gish Jen. Gish Jen is the author of 6 previous books, which include Tiger Writing, Art, Culture, and the Interdependent Self. Her stories have appeared frequently in The New Yorker, The Atlantic Monthly, and dozens of other periodicals and anthologies. She has been nominated for a National Book Critics Circle Award, and her many awards include a Lannan Literary Award for Fiction and a Guggenheim Fellowship. This evening, she joins us to talk about her new book, The Girl at the Baggage Claim, Explaining the East-West Culture Gap. Here, she draws on sociological and psychological studies, as well as on her own experience as the daughter of Chinese immigrants, to examine how culture shapes identity. Please join me now in welcoming Gish Jen to Politics and Prose.
Really is an incredible pleasure to be here. Questions?
Well, when I last saw you, you were about to go off to Harvard to give the Massey Lectures with a certain amount of trepidation,
oh
I think.
God.
And now suddenly you're a cultural icon of East-West culture. What happened to the novelist, and where? I hope the novelist is coming back.
Well, you know, I don't. You know, I feel like just like Ang Lee, I'm just kind of morphing. You know what I mean? I mean, it would be hard for me to believe that I would never go back to the novel. But that said, you know, I haven't. You know, I feel, in part from doing this work, a kind of new freedom. Like maybe the novel, but maybe not. You know, maybe not.
Was it the Massey Lectures that kind of got you thinking?
Well, yeah, I think that up until that point, you know, I was, you know, I was a fiction writer, and I would never, I don't think, have, you know, have taken on the project of learning to write nonfiction had they not asked me to do those lectures. But I didn't have a choice, you know, and also I will say that I tried very hard not to have to give those lectures.
Yeah, I remember.
You know, but I do live in Cambridge, and so they asked me, and I said, you know, I'm working on a novel. I really can't, you know, they asked me again. I'm working on a novel. And the minute I was done with my novel, I said, oh, thank God, I'm done with my novel. Boom. So I did have to give them. And then I found that I really enjoyed it. I mean, that was kind of the big surprise. I mean, those lectures were a lot of pressure, and so maybe I didn't enjoy the pressure part. But I was kind of surprised the way that writing nonfiction, at least the way I was doing it, was very much like writing a novel, which is to say that for me it was a big adventure. It wasn't like I just had some plan and it was just execute. It was like it was a process of discovery the whole way. I mean, I didn't know where I was going, and it was fun. It was fun. And I think in this book too, you can really see that in one way, yes, it's nonfiction. In another way, there's a lot of storytelling, and the structure is a very much a novelistic structure. So it seemed to be kind of in some new, like what I feel a new kind of playing field. You know, I don't know what it is, you know. I'm not really sure. I can't really say, well, does that mean I will go back to the novel? Well, I go back to the novel in a different way. I don't know, but I do sort of feel like I've gone off on this grand adventure. It was a big leap for me to sort of say, like, okay, I'm done with Massey's Lectures, and now I'm going to write another book of nonfiction, like, for the general audience, you know, i.e. not a captive audience. That was a big leap for me, but as you can see, I did it.
And you probably wouldn't have written this book if you had not given the Massey Lectures. Would you say that?
Yes, absolutely. But what's also true, but I think it's true for many writers too, one book always leads to the next book. So, you know, if I hadn't written Typical American, I would never have written Nimona. If I hadn't written, you know what I mean? In other words, it's always that way. So in that way, it's funny, it doesn't seem, I think that, although people have been asking me, because it seems to be discontinuous to other people, to me, it doesn't feel that discontinuous.
Hi, Gish.
Hi.
So happy to see you. I would love to hear you talk more about the different concepts of originality versus the continuum of culture. And I'm thinking of especially years ago when I was at the Sackler Gallery, a book on Zheng De Chen, where his paintings, if he could make a painting that was accepted by the Met as a 6th century Chinese scroll painting, it was an honor and not necessarily a forgery.
Yeah.
Even though he had found the stamps and aged the paper, etc.
Well, you know, this is a very big subject, you know, copying intellectual property. Actually, I'm going to talk about this more at the law school at Harvard on Wednesday. But, you know, once you have a flexi self, right, and, you know, this is your model of self, the greatest truths are not within. That's not to say there's no truth within. It's just a matter of where the balance is, right? But the balance of wisdom is outside of you. So before you dare to say anything, you absorb, right? And what's the best way of absorbing? Well, the best way of absorbing is by copying, right? And so, you know, all the great masters were trained this way. And now there's still this, when people sort of say, oh my God, it's so robotic. It's not robotic in that they don't just copy anything. I mean, they copy something that speaks to them. You know, they copy something which they feel is great. So it starts there. So it's not like this passive thing. Also, I think in a lot of Asian, you know, because it's very related to memorization too, the same thing, that they see memorization as a very active thing. It's not just, if we did it, we would be doing it in this rote way. But they're not doing it in this rote way. They are internalizing it. They're making it organic and part of themselves. And then they hope to add. Now, that does mean that in the process of doing this, they will make copies that were just absolutely unbelievable in their fidelity, and they are proud of that, and rightly so, because honestly, what we're copying, this stuff is incredibly difficult. I think, especially when you're talking about this ink painting on silk, it is incredibly unforgiving. It's, you know what I mean? You cannot correct anything. It's one time through. You know, the idea that you could sit down and copy this great painting with no mistakes, one time through, ink on silk, it really is an unbelievable achievement. That said, I think that for the most part, maybe your person was content to kind of stop there. Most of them actually want to add something of their own to the tradition at that point. So it's really mostly that it's just the matter of that first they must become a master. But that's very different than our idea of the genius, right? Where it's all within, above all, you must not be influenced, right? We have anxiety of influence. We try to forget the past, start, you know what I mean? We want literature, painting, whatever, to start with us. And the Asian view is very different. The Asian view is much greatness lies behind you. And by the way, much greatness lies ahead of you, you know? So that, if you have a student and your student copies your work, that is homage, and you are not offended. You are flattered, you know, because that says that they when they make the decision of like what is great, they look to you, you know what I mean? They look to you, and they thought you were the model. So it's a wonderful thing to be part of this continuum. Like I say, that stands in very great contrast, you know, to the rest of my world. The first thing you'll say if somebody writes like Hemingway is like, oh my God, that's so derivative, exactly. Right? I mean, you might do that for, you know, as a joke, you know what I mean? If anybody says, oh my God, that's really Hemingway-esque, it's not a compliment, right? Yeah, so there's a very big difference. Mel.
First of all, I love the book. I want everybody to read it. It's just wonderful. And one of the things that I really enjoyed about it was that you brought in so many different resources, research that people had done, asking questions I never would have thought to pursue in research. So I guess I want to ask you, if you could direct research going forward, what would be some of the questions you would like to see answered? And I also am hoping that you will tell the story that led to the title, because I thought that was a wonderful example of exactly what you're talking about.
You know, in terms of, you know, are you talking about areas of research or the way that I would like to see people research? Well, I will say that in a general kind of way, that the way that I did this book, which is not a very scholarly way, but, you know, I feel like I'm playing, you know. It wasn't a very playful way. I mean, one of the reasons, you know, it's that you can, and you can see that, I think, that I actually, I read all the research, but when I thought about what I would actually put in my book and actually really use, it was what was interesting to me, you know. And so, you know what I mean? So this is not like the be-all and end-all, and, you know, this is not the definitive work on cultural psychology. It is cultural psychology as it was filtered through me. And I have to say that it seems to me that, it worked for me. So, you know, and others have actually also said that, you know, like, wow, you know, I'm going to tell my writers to try this. So I do recommend this as a method. It's actually related to the way that I used to do my research for other books, in that, you know, people used to say, oh, my God, you know, I write everything down. I would say to the students, I don't write everything down because it's too much. And then when you do, you know, you're writing, it will sound like you did all this research. If it's a good detail, you will remember it. Don't worry. So use your, you know, use the fact that you only remember some things. Use that to help you sort through what to use and not what not to use. In terms of first future directions, I would love to see somebody work on gender, you know. But that's a huge thing. And it wasn't for me at this time. It's a huge thing. The girl that baggage claim, you know, that is a story that I heard in Massachusetts. What happened is that Milton Academy had a girl apply for admission. This is a very elite independent school. The girl was from Asia. She had great TOEFL scores. She had a great essay. She had a great Skype interview. So they were very excited. They sent her their admissions package. They went to go meet her at the airport. And pretty much as soon as they got to the airport, they realized that something was not quite right. And then as the course of the semester went on, it became clear to everyone that this was not the girl who had done the Skype interview. It was her sister. And the heads of independent schools everywhere were shocked, you know. But the funny thing was that, you know, I was and I wasn't shocked. I mean, of course it was fraud. I mean, there's no, you know, to me this is absolutely no can do in America, period, right? But the idea of substituting one person for another, you hear all the time in Asia, all the time. And that's because, if you are a member of, you know, of a family, if you have a pit self, it's very easy to see yourselves as a kind of team, right? And so the same way in a relay race, if like somebody goes out, then you just substitute in somebody else. People kind of have this substitution idea. I mean, that's just part of life. Last semester, I was taking Chinese, had a wonderful tutor, and she told me the story that you know, she had a friend who was very academically distinguished, but who was really a terrible, terrible athlete. And their school had a physical fitness requirement for graduation. And so, you know, this friend was not going to pass this test. So what to do? Well, of course. My tutor, of course, went and did the long jump for her. If you can believe that they have to do the long jump to graduate. Which she did so well that her friend was immediately recruited for track and field. But to them, this is not some, you know, this, there's no taboo around it. You know, this is not this terrible, you know, terrible thing that they've done. This is a lot more like, you know, you parked illegally, you really shouldn't have done it, but you just had to have those donuts, and you gotta, right? You know, it's much more like that in their view. We don't take it anywhere near as lightly. But I mean, but that's one of the ways that, you know, people talk a lot about, you know, whether Asia is changing. And, you know, so there's been a lot of books written, you know, like, you know, the rise of the individual, you know, China is now individualistic. China is changing, and it is more individualistic than it was. But when you hear stories like this, about this kind of substitution, and you know, a lot of the things, the intellectual property issues, and so on, you realize that it is changing, but it is not America. Yeah. Yes.
Yes. Thanks. This is admittedly a very broad question.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I would be interested in your thoughts about the prospects for bridging the gap between the two cultures and achieving some degree of understanding of the difference that you outlined so well in your book. And I'm thinking in particular about some of the geopolitical implications of the current gulf between the two cultures. So
yeah, well, I would have to say that this is not the moment, you know, we're for great optimism, you know. I mean, in terms of bridging the gulf, I mean, it just isn't, right? On a more personal level, I think that, you know, you see more and more people going back and forth. And I think that you see more and more people developing what I call ambidependence, meaning they have both selves, you know? And which, and I guess if there was something that I wanted in my book, it would be to sort of encourage that, so that the people who have a flexi self do not feel that that is a, there's a stigma around that, and that they have to kind of hide that in some way. And I think quite the contrary. I think it should really be celebrated. And I think that there are so many people in that category actually now, that actually, if they all even step forward, I mean, I think that you would see a change in sort of the dominant discourse. Right now, you know, because, you know, the big corporations, they think they know what we want, and they think what message will appeal to us, and they, you know, they're reifying. I think actually, if people had their full selves on display, they might discover that those are not the only messages that they actually respond to, and we might have a different kind of cycle of reinforcement that might, I think, bring us back from this very extreme individualism that, frankly, is not working for many people. I think it's a little bit like the proposed healthcare plan. I mean, it works for some people, you know? I mean, I think that the individualism we have right now works for very healthy people who don't need anybody else, you know? But for people, for the elderly, for children, for, you know, and for other people, just for reasons that, you know, that go beyond kind of being needy. Other people like to be in closer contact to others in a more reliable way. And it seems to me that that should be one of the American options. You know, I think it should not be something which is somehow un-American. Other questions?
Yeah. A quick question. What do you know what happened to the tank man? I mean, I was interested in
Nobody knows, very sadly. You know, it's one of these things, of course, everybody assumes that he's dead. Mm-hmm. But we don't know that. And everybody assumes that the people who took him right after that incident, they assume that were police, but it could easily have been friends. I mean, the answer is nobody knows, you know?
Yeah, I ask in part because some of what you're saying it is, in many respects, and I don't have the depth of knowledge you have, is so inconsistent with my own experience in working with human rights activists in Asia. So I'm finding a little bit the sort of some of I think what you're saying seems to me, as you've said, it's playful. It's not, you know, you don't mean to generalize about everything, but some of it seems wrong.
Please tell me.
Well, again, most of my human rights experience is in other places in the world, but my work in Cambodia and in Indonesia, and a little bit in Malaysia, again, generalization. It's not that they accept the oppression because this is some kind of cultural thing that they have to put up with, and that the individual human rights advocates are some kind of Western interference. It's not that at all. They want a consensus in terms of how they are ruled, and that's not what most of people are living with. So that's my experience. And then the other point, to fight back a little bit more, again, believe me, a limited experience, seeing with our own children and their classmates who are in college settings where they are children coming from China, the idea that they are cheating somehow or that they would easily substitute a friend to take an exam is not my experience at all. At the same time, on the more critical end of it, I went to a class and I asked my daughter who the person was who was putting her hand up all the time. And she said, oh, that's Mei Wen or whatever, she's from China. She hasn't figured out that there's no right and wrong answer. And I thought that's so fascinating. It's another aspect of this kind of a more negative effect of always having to reach enforced consensus, or if your culture is telling you all the time, which I don't buy, but if your culture is telling you all the time that you have to make do or get with the program, you miss something. So we're again, I haven't thought about this as evident terribly much, but it strikes me that you're speaking in extremes, and while I recognize the guy in the video, I think there are many collective aspects of American culture that you're caricaturing a bit or missing or?
You know, I've written a long book and this is a short talk.
I know it is. I know it is.
So I kind of, you know, so when I sort of say, you know, there's kind of this, there's two ends of a spectrum. And, yeah. You know, of course, it's very complicated. Yeah. I'm really trying to establish, it's just like trying to establish a, you know, any kind of framework. You know, like say, okay, like if we were going to go in the world, let's just think about if we had north, south, east, west, like what a useful idea that would be.
Right.
You know, so I'm sort of, that's kind of where I am, really. I will say a couple of things, though, and that is that one of the stereotypes, and it was hard for me to write this book because I was so aware that people with a certain frame of mind would use this to support stereotypes. Do you know what I mean? And I myself am a victim of stereotypes. I don't support stereotyping. At the same time, it seemed to me it was vastly unproductive to suggest that there's no difference when there is difference. Do you know what I mean? In other words, it seemed to me not leading in a helpful direction for anybody. But I will say that the whole idea that people who are interdependent are in any way passive is completely wrong. And that would really support what you're saying. Mm-hmm. So that if you're sort of saying, well, but wait, most of the people I know, they're very active and they are very actively opposing oppression. And I would say that is absolutely right. And the idea that you would think that someone with a flexi self wouldn't do that is the way that these ideas can be used to kind of support stereotypes.
Mm-hmm.
But actually what I am trying to say is that you can have a flexi self and you are absolutely very, very actively shaping your world and actively opposing oppression. In fact, I mean, sometimes it seems like that's all they do, mm-hmm. to be honest. I mean, they are very, very actively doing that. But they're doing it, you'll often see them doing it together. Do you know what I mean? I mean, mm-hmm. In other words, what they're doing is they are making kind of an in-group around themselves, and the government is the out-group. But you'll see the way they're doing it. Their idea about themselves, the level of self-sacrifice, for instance, mm-hmm. is much higher. If you think about something like Vietnam, and you think about the Kuchi tunnels, mm-hmm. and you think about the people who lived in those tunnels for year after year after year after year, mm-hmm. the answer is there was a level of self-sacrifice that the Vietnamese were capable of that, you know what I mean, to us was just mind-blowing, mm-hmm. right? And we completely did not anticipate, and it was unimaginable to us. Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm sort of saying. So are they highly active? Are they highly resistant? Yes. I mean, I would say that was highly active and highly resistant. Mm-hmm. Are they accepting of oppression? No, absolutely mm-hmm. not. Are they doing it in a way which you would have to characterize as very different than the way that oppression, you know, that resistance would be carried out in the United States? Yes. Do you see what I'm do you
yeah,
see what I mean?
Yeah, I have to think and about then,
it. Vis-a-vis collective action in the United States, what's different about it is that it has a voluntary aspect to it, so that so you do these things because it is an expression of your values, and that is a very powerful thing. Look, we had the Women's March; it's a very powerful thing,
mm-hmm.
but that is different than the kind of collective action that you could typically see in Asia, where it is not a matter; it is not elective. You just do it because that is your duty. That's what duty means. So that like an example of this would be your treatment of the elderly. You know, or well, okay, this isn't everybody, but you know, a friend of mine in Cambridge recently said, you know, I'm taking care of this my parent. You know, I want it to be this sort of joyful expression. I want mm-hmm. it to be, you know, I want it to be, you know, an expression of all that we are, and you know, the circle of life, and so on. And, you know, and he was just very disappointed because it wasn't that, you know, because mm-hmm. he actually had a terrible relationship with his mother and so on, you know. You know, a more Asian view would just be, you just do it.
Suck it up, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not even to suck it up. It's just like, you wouldn't think not to do it. I mean, mm-hmm. it's just like, you know, you get up, you get in the morning, you open your eyes. That's what you do, you mm-hmm. know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, you know, it doesn't have this feel. You don't go back and forth thinking, do I want to do this? Do I not want to do it? You just do it. And that's where the difference lies. So it's true that in both In both sort of cultures, you will see collective action. And in both cultures, you will see, you know, independent action. But one of the reasons I wanted to get away from the word independent for the pit self, mm-hmm. was exactly because it suggested that the other self wasn't independent. You know, how can we have all these students here so far from home? Do you know what I mean? Kind of all right. by themselves if they weren't independent. Obviously, a flexi self is capable of independent action. Does that make sense?
It does.
I don't know if this helps.
Yeah, I mean, when I think of individuals, Lou Jabot and their famous people who went and are now in prison by themselves and because of things they did as individuals.
Well, yes, of course, they're capable of independent action.
Yeah.
And they're acting independently and as individuals. Mm-hmm. But the question is, you know, how in their meaning making, do you know what I mean? Was an expression, who are they doing it for? Do you know what I mean? And where did those ideas come from? So, like, a lot of people say, well, you know, a lot of the Asians, you know, they spend a lot of time in self-reflection. They're all by themselves. You know, they're meditating. You know, isn't that individualistic? But meditation is not actually individualistic in that, A, the ideas are coming from without, mm-hmm. and, B, you're trying to actually get rid of the self, and you're trying to dissolve the boundary between you and the universe so that it looks individualistic in the sense that you're doing it by yourself quietly in a room. But the actual activity, I would argue, is a flexi-self activity. That's why I tried to get rid of that word individualism. I mean, I had to use it still, but I think that it, you know, it's come to mean something, you know, in our culture, which is, I think, just confusing. You know what I mean? Because, yeah, like, they will say, well, of course they're individual, and they are individuals. And if you sort of say, well, and of course, you know, are they different from each other? Of course they're different. I mean, you know, what's different is what the meaning that they attach to difference. Do you know what I mean? So do you think that the most important thing about you is that you're unique? Well, as we were discussing from, the, you know, this discussion of the painting might suggest, actually, the most important thing about you is not that you're unique. Are you unique? Yes, you're unique, but it's not the most important thing about you.
Okay.
Yes.
That was a long and abstract and complicated and wonderful
so
discussion, and I want to lighten it
so
up
sorry.
A little bit and tell you that two decades ago I was in Hong Kong as a Fulbright senior scholar teaching Hong Kong students in an American Studies program, and we read Mona in the Promised Land.
Oh my God.
And they loved it. But what really, and this links with your discussion just now, what really amazed them was the changing of identities. You know, that a Chinese character wishing to become Jewish, and the flexibility there in the Promised Land to do that. They seemed very surprised that that could happen because they're very purely not just Chinese. They are very purely Hong Kong.
Yeah.
And so the idea that we would just sort of willy-nilly become some other complete identity amazed them. So maybe you could put that together with the girl in the baggage claim. I'm with Jack. I'm waiting for another novel too.
Oh. Thank you. You know, this idea that it does come in the sense that in our view, right, identity is elective, right? And so that if in my pit I feel more Jewish than I do Chinese, I get to say. But from their point of view, it's not elective. This is what goes back to what we're talking about duty, you know, your culture is your culture. And if you think that Jewish culture is your culture, you are just gravely mistaken. But some of you who know me will know that actually I am Jewish. That's true. Well, you know, I actually see some people nodding, and I suspect that, you know, so. But flexi self, I think most people, in truth, I think, are ambidependent. And I have to say that, you know, that when most of the people I know, clearly, people who are close to me, they always turn out to be ambidependent. You know, so it's almost as like, you know, it's funny, your sister had a very nice party for me in Boston. And I just looked out of the room and I said, you know, for those of you who are wondering what you are, I can tell you, you're all ambidependent. That's because my friends are all ambidependent because, you know what I mean? Like those, if they weren't, I wouldn't become close to them. you know? It's interesting, but, you know, I really have seen this over the years. So, but other questions?
You ready for
Yes, please.
I'm a little bit worried I'm going to be asking to launch into more stereotypes, so we know these are generalizations. Okay. But I'm just wondering, and both in America maybe and in the East, if you think men or women are more likely, if there's a difference, we flexi self and pit self by gender.
You know, that's an excellent question. And, you know, I have to say when I was writing my book, I had to sort of push that question aside. I touch on it a couple of times, but because it's so huge. But I would say if I had to answer in as simply as I can, with lots of caveats, and like I will say with in my book too, there's like, you know, but Armenia is there's an exception everywhere. With this too, an exception everywhere. But same thing, that probably if you were to draw two curves, right, of men and women, and you were to graph them against their relative, big pit self or flexi self, you know, the answer is you're going to get two curves, I think. You know, there's a lot of overlap. There are a lot of outliers, you know, it's very messy. But I think that in a very general kind of way, I think women tend to be more flexi self. You know, I say, you can shoot me. There are exceptions everywhere, right? And what about an Asian man? And what about, you know, and these things are so malleable, you know, so much depends on where the person grew up and, you know, there's so many things. But probably there are two curves.
Hi. Over 40 years ago, I took a course in college with a professor named Francis Hsu, and he wrote a book. He was an anthropologist, and he wrote a book called The Americans and the Chinese. Huh. And if you don't know it, it's just wonderful. And part of he was comparing in a similar kind of way. And I think, and of course this really tests my memory, but I think that one of the focuses among the Chinese was he talked about the Confucian ideal and how that was extremely influential in creating the culture. So that's what I...
Well, it's true that Confucius has been incredibly important. And, you know, it's what's so interesting to me, you know, when people talk about the flexi self, especially as it exists in China, which, and I have to say that as you go worldwide, you know, obviously you can have the same sort of structure of self, and takes on many different flavorings depending on where you are, right? But what's so interesting about China is that China, given that both selves tend to, you know, have pluses and minuses, that China developed some social structures that dealt extremely well with the downsides of the flexi self, and they were very smart about it. So it's kind of like they had the self, but they were, you know, but there's all these things that they did, and then they kind of drilled into the self to make it work for millennia, you know. So that's sort of an interesting, and that's a whole nother, that would be another great research project, I think, for someone now, would be kind of like, so what really, you know what I mean, what do you need for a society to really flourish? Given certain structures, cultural structures, you know, what kind of a government works well, you know what I mean, with that structure, and what will the results be? I think it's fair to say that if we're just thinking about China and the U.S. right now, on both sides, we have very problematic governments. So it's kind of an interesting time to sort of think about, well, you know, given the cultures, you know, what, but I don't think it's as simple as like, well, they should have our government. You know, I mean, that is obviously not the answer. But, an interesting question would be, well, what would be a government? You know, like, what would be a good government that would bring the kind of order that every society needs, but without cramping them in an unpleasant way?
Thank you. This is not really a question. It's very quick echoing to what you said earlier. So there are a lot of immigrants from Asia who are in this country who really thrive, right? Who really thrive, who work very hard, who have strong motivations. And I have some friends who are coming from China, young people doing really well. But if you ask them, why do you come to America? It's not surprising. A lot of them will say, because my parents want me to. And I had this question directed to me millions of times, and I always feel very proud to answer. It's because my mom and dad wanted me to. And I live a good life here, and I just feel very good. I fulfilled their dream. So there's nothing to be afraid of saying, because I do this because my parents want me to.
Yeah.
At least as a Chinese, I feel that way.
That's, you are exactly right. And that's what I'm trying to say, you know. But here, there's like, right, you are, you know, you haven't completely developed or something. You know, I mean, you know, that's the Western view. But my view is not that. It's just a different system. It's a different system, and it has nothing to do with, you're not on your way to becoming this other person. You are a different person, a different kind of person with different kind of, with different values. And it's so interesting because, you know, there's a study of Asian American kids done in California, you know, where the kids were, you know, the kids are little and they were given puzzles. And, you know, and the question is, you know, did they do better, and did they persist? You know, did they perform better doing the puzzle if they picked it themselves than if their parents picked it? And these Asian American kids in second generation, they picked better. They performed better if the parents picked it, like they had more faith that this was a good puzzle. The parents knew that they would like the puzzle, and therefore it was, you know what I mean, rather than a random puzzle. Well, who knows if they would like this puzzle or not? Do you know? It's sort of interesting. As in terms of what, you know, how they go on, the answers, they go on to be happy adults. I mean, there's nothing about preferring to have your parents actually be a guide for you. There's nothing about that stunts your growth in some way. You know what I mean? You're not, you know. Anyway, I'm telling you what you just told me.
We have time for one more question.
One more question.
Yes, yeah. I wanted to ask, so you're talking about the differences between pit self and the flexi self. Is there like a middle where people can come together, can I choose to, or is it something that naturally happens, and like how to come to the middle? I don't know.
Well, you know, this is what I'm saying. I'm hoping with globalization that, you know, that people will develop both selves, and that, oh, by the way, you know, you not only is it, you know, not only is it a spectrum, but, you know, you move back and forth, you know, on the spectrum depending on your circumstances. But in terms of if you were a very big pit self person, and you wanted to develop a flexi self, it's been shown that if you go and live in Asia for a while, you will. You know, I mean, you know, so you know, I think that, you know, certainly, you know, you will test in ways which, you know, where cultural psychologists can look at your testing and can identify your patterns as more flexi self, you know, within 7 months. So, if you stay there for a couple of years, you might find yourself being really. Really, quite flexi self, and then you could have both, you know. And the answer is, I think that there's been a tendency to think of the state of having both as being a state of being in eternal conflict. But I think there can be conflict. Obviously, these systems are very different. We're hearing different cultural messages, and you know, it can be kind of confusing. But if I had hope for something in my book, it would be that people would realize that you can be conflicted, but it's also a tremendous gift. Do you mean so that it is a tremendous gift? Do not try to resolve this conflict and get rid of this other self. You know, hold on to it, I would say, for dear life.
Thank you so much.